It is written, many are called, but few are chosen. I like to think of it a little differently. Many are called, but few choose. I've been chosen to lead the North Pole Inner Earth Expedition. My name is Brooks Agnew, and I choose to start here. Mount Shasta, 9,000 feet, shrouded in the mists of mystery. To begin what may be the greatest geological expedition in the history of the world. To discover if the Earth is hollow or not. Join us.
You may ask, who am I that I should lead this most intrepid group of people on this expedition? Well, I have been privileged with the highest callings there are, that of teacher, scientist, engineer, talk show host of X Squared Radio, but most of all, I am an Earth explorer. My family came to Scotland from ancient lands in the 13th century and founded Stranraer and the lands called Galloway. They built this magnificent castle overlooking Loch Na high in the hills above the western coast. The Agnew clan served as magistrates over land transfers. In the early 15th century, the Ross clan sold a tract of land to the Sinclairs from France. The chapel at Rosslyn is one of the most famous centers of holy power on earth. It is believed that the Ark of the Covenant once was housed here. A most remarkable history is preserved behind these doors. The Agnews were the hereditary sheriffs of Galloway, Knights of Christ, who protected Rosslyn Chapel from plunder for over 350 years. The symbols are cross-fertilized between Agnew Castle and Rosslyn Chapel. The Scottish Cross, the Templar's Square, and the Flowers of Life adorn both buildings. The Agnew-Ross bloodline is preserved through one living heir, yours truly. Why hollow earth theory? One of the earliest theories proposed was in 1692 by Edmund Halley. Edmund Halley was a brilliant English astronomer whose mathematical calculations pinpointed the return of the comet that bears his name. Halley was fascinated by the Earth's magnetic field. Halley came to believe that the Earth was hollow and within it was a second sphere with another field. Halley also suggested that the interior of the Earth was populated with life and lit by a luminous atmosphere. He thought the aurora borealis, or northern lights, were caused by the escape of this gas through a thin crust at the poles. In 1846, the discovery of an extinct woolly mammoth frozen in ice in Siberia was used by Marshall Gardiner as evidence of a hollow Earth. Gardiner subscribed to the single sun inside the earth theory and suggested that the mammoth was so well preserved because it had died recently. Gardiner thought that mammoths and other extinct creatures wandered freely in the interior of the earth. This one had wandered outside by using the hole at the North Pole, then was frozen and carried to Siberia on an ice floe. As time has gone on, the idea of a hollow earth has become less a theory of fringe science and more a subject of science fiction and fantasy. It seems the more science discovers about the structure of the earth, the more popular the theory seems to become. Evidence that seems to allow the possibility is routinely thrown out by scientists. United States Navy Admiral Richard Byrd flew across the North Pole in 1926 and the South Pole in 1929 and reportedly told of his observation that lush green forests, mammoths, and flowing water appeared below his aircraft where none should have been. Over the years, we've collected space data using satellite photography, using orbiting experiments. We've also collected Earth-based data by examining evidence on the ice, evidence in the sky, evidence in the sea, evidence from earthquakes, and finally, from human consciousness itself.
This is where the mystique begins. Tibetan Buddhism where the first real expressions of the inner earth in religion begin.
Tibetan Buddhism was created by King Tsongchang Gampo in the 7th century. The king had conquered 9 empires, including China. Instead of imposing Tibet upon them, he took the hands in marriage of 9 princesses. Part of the terms of this marriage was that they each had to bring part of their native culture. Tibetan Buddhism was founded.
The North Pole Inner Earth Expedition has brought us here to Tibet, high above the city of Lhasa, almost 14,000 feet. Behind me is the symbol of Tibetan Buddhism. At the core of their belief is this symbol. In the center, you'll see the yin and yang. From that, you'll see rays of light coming out to an outer ring. That ring is full of foliage. This is also recognized around the world as a universal symbol of an inner earth.
When Buddhism was introduced in this form, using the inner earth symbolism, the animals came to sit in peace and listen. Often, deer or peacocks are used to depict nature's endorsement of this union of dimensions as the story of life and creation. These symbols exist in every ancient culture, but nowhere are they in more pure form than in Tibet. The use of circular mandalas is prolific. The expression of life energy and vibrant harmonies promotes deep feelings in nearly everyone who sees them. The relationship of man to the earth and the recognition of cyclic energy from within the earth is openly expressed. Children and adults alike express a sort of remembrance and ancient passion when they see these mandalas. It's as if something about them reminds us of home.
We're standing inside a mandala with 108 sacred runes, ornately painted, but built several hundred feet high on top of an iron mountain in the foothills of the Himalayas, over 14,000 feet up. This is where the mandalas came from. The Nuwaras that built this building built it by design. It is said that if one meditates through all 108 rooms of this mandala building, you will reach enlightenment. The power here is unbelievable.
Like the empires of the Nile, the transporting of the human soul from this world to the worlds of higher dimensions was paramount. The construction of highly complex and specialized structures for Tibetan burials of Panchen Lamas and Dalai Lamas, or holy reincarnated leaders, was facilitated by the stupa. This structure is over 60 feet tall and uses more than 4,300 pounds of gold and 10,000 jewels. There is no precursor for this structure. It is built with purpose and has been copied countless times all over the country. One of the most remarkable things is its striking resemblance to a Tesla coil. To clearly make the point, the 14th Panchen Lama constructed this modern version in 1989 to rebury the desecrated mummies of the 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th Panchen Lamas. On the ceiling, perfectly centered above the golden arch in which the mummies are housed, is a four-dimensional Stargate mandala. The temple in Shigatse houses one of the many statues of Maitreya, the future Buddha. Surrounded by what are described as giants, the future Buddha is visited by many thousands of pilgrims each year who come here to seek a torch of victory over the challenges of their lives. Another remarkable thing is the use of glass ornaments of different sizes and colors to represent the appearance of orbs. Usually only revealed in filmed or digital camera images, these are ascended masters or higher dimensional intelligences who come to assist people who can raise their consciousness to a point where these intelligences can appear as geometrical orbs. These ornaments give the dimensionally blind person hope that the ascended masters are here, watching and offering their love and assistance. The expedition to discover the meaning of the legend of a hollow earth brought us here to Tibet. We found a religious tradition with powerful symbols of higher consciousness and the origins of the planet itself. The land of Tibet is rich in minerals and heritage, but not much has changed over the last 1,000 years in the way the Tibetan people live. They are devout and peaceful, but it seems the people are smiling and simple on the outside while holding a sacred and secret knowledge on the inside. We discovered that the most holy sites in Tibet tell of giants of old who brought highly advanced technology here capable of opening and operating stargates. These giants were the protectors of the ancient Buddha who taught the people the principles of compassion and love. They also demonstrated their stargate devices and revealed higher dimensions to the early Tibetans. A dozen centuries later, the people are still building golden replicas of that technology. They tie their intricate mandala paintings of the stargates to the enlightenment of the human soul. And they still build and care for golden statues of their ancient leaders. The Stargate replicas don't actually function. Maybe they witnessed them work once and have forgotten how they work. Maybe they are waiting for the giants to return and open the Stargates once again. Perhaps they can bear the occupation of their country and the exile of their holy leader because they have hope of the reunion between the dimensions they include in their religion. And perhaps they already know what other civilizations have also immortalized in stone, that humans are multidimensional beings capable of outlasting all adversities and envisioning where the most powerful creative life force of the universe really lies, inside each of us. How did such advanced spiritual and technological concepts find their way into the core religious beliefs of such an isolated society? How did the symbolic representations of an inner earth arise in this ancient land? Our journey to Tibet has generated many new questions, but few answers. These new discoveries of yet another link between human consciousness and hidden knowledge of an inner world provide even more fuel for our quest for the truth. And our quest must ultimately lead us to the one place where the truth can be found, The next area of exploration for the Inner Earth Expedition to discover the source of the legend is a region near the North Pole, the land from whence the warm wind blows, the source of the Aurora Borealis, the place where it said there lays an elusive opening between a surface world where the sun shines and the stars twinkle in the night, and an inner world, a land with no horizon. One might think that with today's capabilities in the fields of satellite photography and geophysical surveys, that the existence of an inner Earth would have either been proven or refuted by the existing data. Sadly, we have no way of knowing, because the powerful entities who control such data from the polar regions have seen to it that this knowledge remains secret. Most of us are familiar with our world as we view it from weather satellites on the evening news. These satellites go around the planet from east to west or from west to east. There are a few satellites called polar satellites that go around the Earth, North and South Pole. However, data is not available to the public for a view of the North Pole or the South Pole, only the center section. There are only a few polar satellites. In February of 2006, the federal government issued a data denial implementation plan which secures the continued flow of real-time meteorological satellite data from the NOAA, provided instruments on board EUMETSAT's METCOP spacecraft to public duty users in the United States. During episodes that might otherwise require data denial means real-time data from U.S. environmental instruments can be denied during periods of crisis or war. There are no publicly available images of the North Pole. When a solar flare occurs, cosmic radiation leaps out into space, crossing the distance from the Sun to the Earth in about 73 hours. As it approaches the planet, it can often form an aurora borealis, also known as the northern lights, ribbons of light as cosmic radiation turns into light above our planet, approaching from the north or the south pole of our planet. But what would cause an aurora borealis to form over both poles at the same time? Find out as we explore our world during the North Pole Inner Earth Expedition. In this slide of space photography, one can see the city lights blurred below as the beautiful blue-green aurora borealis is captured with the solar wind passing gracefully around the planet Earth. Solar flares explode from the sun's surface hundreds of thousands of miles into space. These emit X-rays, high-energy particles, and gamma rays that travel on a solar wind to Earth in about 73 hours. The Earth's magnetosphere is generated by the crust rotating around a solid metallic core. Without this magnetosphere, the surface of the Earth would be completely sterilized. Unlike traditional gravity theories, gravity actually centers in the crust of the Earth. Are there openings in the Earth's crust that lead to an interior world? We are about to explore and find out. Originally, as the Earth formed from particles surrounding the Sun in what's called an accretion disk, the Earth formed in a ball and exhibited a condition called overspin. As the crust expanded, the Earth slowed down to its present rate. What is left behind is a gap between the core and the crust. Molten rock fills in the gaps left by the expansion of Earth's crust. Earth was once one-third its present diameter. It's easily seen that all of the continents once fit together like a key and a lock. The crust has expanded enough so that now ocean fills in the space between the continents. One can see from this graph that in the last 25 years, earthquakes have increased in intensity and frequency. The rate of increase is alarming. Every time there is a major earthquake, geologists collect an MRI of the Earth. That is to say, vibrations travel from the point of earthquake to the other side of the planet, where precision accelerometers reveal a detailed picture of what the Earth may look like on the inside. Unfortunately, each time one of these events occurs, there is a series of shadow waves or unexplained waves left behind. This example out of a common textbook is exactly what geological students see each year. Each time they have to accommodate the shadow zone. We believe this is a broken model, as does Jan Lambrecht, who also took the same math data and worked it backwards to see if the MRI could reveal the true structure of the inner Earth. In this slide, you can see there is a model that works without exception, every time. As the vibration occurs on one side of the planet, it passes through the crust, but does not pass through the open air area between the crust and the core. Instead, it passes freely around, reflecting to the other side. There are no shadow zones in this model. The math works perfectly every time. In actuality, as the Earth forms, it forms into a sphere rather than a solid ball. The center of gravity, as shown here, is actually in the middle of the crust. Think of it as if you were standing in an elevator on a bathroom scale, and the elevator traveled to the center of the Earth from the surface. As you went lower and lower, your body weight would actually drop, until when you finally reached the center of the Earth, your body weight might actually be negative. According to Newtonian physics, as matter coagulates or aggregates in space, the amount of gravity associated with that mass increases with its weight. If those Newtonian physics are in fact accurate, while you're in the center of the Earth, you would actually weigh nothing, because all of the mass of the Earth would be above you. This is why planets form into spheres and not solid balls. In actuality, the acceleration of gravity that we feel on the surface is about 32 feet per second squared. However, standing on the inside of the crust, as though you were standing in China, only on the inside of the Earth, the acceleration would be about a third less, or about 21 feet per second squared. The open air gap between the inside of the crust and what many theorists believe is an inner sun may be as much as 1,200 miles of open air. To put that in perspective, the space shuttle flies at about 200 miles above the surface of the Earth. High-altitude aircraft fly at about 8 miles above the planet. We have about 3 miles of breathable atmosphere on the surface of our planet, whereas in the inner Earth there may be as much as 800 to 1,000 miles of breathable atmosphere. The inner sun may be a glowing ball of metal, providing inner heat and a soft glow for the interior of the Earth. Without a sundown event, there would be no night or day on the inner Earth, simply a soft twilight 24 hours a day. a temperature equilibrium may form, with a minimum of weather. However, with a vast atmosphere, a tropical environment, low in solar radiation, may form the perfect environment for long life and giantism among plants and animals. The idea behind a North Pole passage is that there is a hole or an opening in the crust equalizing the pressure from the interior to the exterior of the planet. The ocean actually coats the crust on the inside and outside of the crust, meaning that there is an outer ocean upon which we sail and an inner ocean, an ocean with no horizon. What we are about to undertake may be the greatest geological expedition in the history of the world. The builders of Rosalind Chapel in the year 1442 wanted us to know the true nature of the earth. Directly above the altar, in the center front of the chapel, in the ceiling, lowered down and carefully ornately carved, a hollow world with an interior sun. Join our expedition, the North Pole Inner Earth Expedition. Our project cost is estimated to be around $2 million. Our mission statement is to build a team with the right skills and the right consciousness to reunite the human race with their family in the inner earth and beyond. Phoenix Science Foundation, in cooperation with Advanced Planetary Explorations, LLC, has formed this expedition to bring the film, the data, and the samples back from the North Pole so that you will know whether the world is in fact hollow or not.
It holds the holiest temple of the Buddhas of the Tibetan people in the town of Lhasa. As you can see, there's a lot of symbolism around this temple. People come from all over China and all over Tibet to this place to take in a pilgrimage to this temple. here we are in the foothills of the Himalayas. We're probably around, I don't know, 15, 16,000 feet. Came across a nomad's campground. Little goats. We're about to make some contact, share some tea and some stories in Tibetan. See if we can find out what life in these mountains is really like.
Ah.